What's up, everyone? It's your boy Shaf, aka That Mill Guy, coming at you with another great interview with another big member of not only the One Piece TCG community as a creator, but also as a Nami player and creator. I wanted to get this great individual on to the channel just as soon as possible, especially with some of the recent things that we've been kind of working on together with the Nami Discord and everything. But those are all conversations for later. I don't want to bury the lead. Introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Lenore. I'm now 23 as of a few weeks ago. And I've been playing Nami since she came out in OPO3. I mean, as soon as I ripped open that pack, read back, alt Nami leader, let's start playing it. As far as TCGs go in general, I've only been playing since about 2021. So I'm still new to card games in general, but I play One Piece, I play Magic, I play a little bit of everything. So yeah.
Okay, perfect. So the larger discussion that we want to have today is while I change my camera direction here, the larger discussion we want to have today is just Nami in general, some discussions around your experience in the community, what you feel about like Nami in terms of its movement in the future, maybe some matchups, a little bit of everything. So strap on in. I'm going to try and do my best with timestamps. I know folks requested timestamps, but if the video is long, please, it's such a nightmare to get timestamps in, especially without an editor. But yes, so let's hop right into the discussion here. Let's start off right into it. So your success and your experience with Nami, you just talked about how, you know, pack fresh, the Nami addiction started. How did that go for you, kind of starting things off?
Oh my god, starting things off, OPO3, I could not get a win with this deck. Ever. Like, it took me, like, till probably late 04, start of 05, when I was like, okay, I think I've cracked the code. I think I know how I want to play this deck, because I used to play, like, the Boodles, the Belmers, the Nojikos, and it just never worked.
Yeah. And I imagine, like, there's a level of, like, not everyone knew what the quote-unquote, like, optimal list was, right? Like, it was a bit of a Wild West. So, you know, people in the comments may be like, why were you playing those cards? I mean, what else were you supposed to do? You were given, the world's your oyster. I mean, no one probably knew. Impel Down, I believe, was like an 0-1 card. Was anyone playing Impel Down? Did people know that it was just good enough to be a trigger? Like, I don't blame you. Like, how are you supposed to win?
Like, I mean, I was even playing, you might not know what this card is, but Dragon Twister.
Dragon Twister? Oh, 4K and bottom deck a 1 cost. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
I used to play that because, like, 04, so we were still seeing, like, the 1-drop top checks. We were still seeing, like, the vanilla statline buggy in like, I don't know what deck it was, a deck that had red, but just like all them 1-drops, I was just like, this is gonna become a 5k swing, I don't want to deal with it. Let me get rid of that.
Well, this is what I mean, like, you were also playing in the heat of the red menace, right? Like, for multiple sets, red was out. Like, we didn't have White Snake. What were you supposed to do? Like, I don't even know. I don't know how you toughed it out. I would have, oh Lord, it would have been a fun deck to play, but it would have been really, I guess, like, diminishing returns when you could have just been playing like Blue Dofi or like Croc or something like that. But yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I guess, so you kind of trudged it through, you started having some success in 04. I personally started in 05, just because I was kind of getting some ads for like the One Piece TCG. And someone in like, I have a mill Discord for Magic, and I was kind of asking around, someone's like, you know, there is a mill deck. I was like, I'm sold. I don't care how good it is. I'm sold. So, you know, obviously I came in with the optimal list. I'm a little spoiled. I didn't have to be there in the trenches, but with that in mind, what did you feel like was some of your favorite cards as the deck was building, like maybe in the beginning, or like, what's your favorite card right now? Like, what does that look like for you?
In the beginning,
you're allowed to say Boodle.
What?
You're allowed to say Boodle. People hate you for it, but you're allowed to say Boodle's your favorite card. I won't shame you.
Boodle was my favorite card once he got the altar.
Yes, I knew it. I love that card. It's the same hesitation. I've talked to so many people and it's the same hesitation. No one wants to say Boodle. I get it. I understand. I understand the value, but okay, Boodle was the favorite card back then. Is it still your favorite card?
You got me stumped here. It's definitely between a few. Let me...
Okay, so we can come back to the question. You know, as we talk more, we can think about it. So I'll say that my personal favorite is Deathwink. I'm a big Deathwink lover. Instant speed peel-offs, just chef's kiss. I'm real sad that... I don't know if we have to let go of it in 07, but I'm definitely a little bit concerned without the card in 07. So I don't know how to feel about it yet in there. But so that's first in mind. So we'll come back to that. Don't worry. Let's think about it. But how were how did you find, like, when you started winning with the list, like, what did you feel like was the switch for you? And I wanted to kind of really discuss this for some newer Nami players out there. Like, what did you feel like was the moment where maybe you started implementing a combo or you started sequencing a certain way that you felt like, oh, I'm winning more now because I'm doing X. Like, was there ever a moment like that for you?
I think it was realizing that bottom decking my cards isn't the worst thing in the world.
With like spotted triggers or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah, no. Or even playing against Sakazuki or Red Purple Lore, like eventually learning that, hey, they're sending good stuff back into my deck.
Yeah.
This isn't the end of the world.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm really happy you mentioned that. So a lot of times people don't realize, like, that's high level thinking right there. That is high level Nami thinking, that they're bottom decking your Kaias, which means you're a late game is really set up, right? Like a Mr. One gets sent down there, that's a gavel. A Kaia gets sent down there, that's a free peel off at the end, right? Like that's high level thinking that a lot of people don't understand, and which is why I think, and feel free to correct me if you believe I'm wrong, I think that's why the Sakazuki matchup can feel 50-50 to a lot of people. Like, it may not be favored or anything, but it feels winnable. If you know, if they're just bottom decking and they're not throwing a bunch of Morias at you, heck, in 05 it was just it was pretty much just throwing out Luchis and 7 cost Borsalitos at you. But if they're not doing that, then it seems not bad in the late game. You kind of just need to get to less than 10 cards and you're kind of there. But I don't know how you feel about that.
Yeah, no, I definitely feel that way. That fucking Moria. I really wish that Moria was legal up.
I don't know what to do about that card either. Like, that card just does so much. Like, okay. We're going to talk about individual colors in there. I may share some feelings about your recent frustrations with purple, but maybe that's because of our biased views on that.
So much gripe with purple.
Hey, you know what? That's a discussion to have for later. It's one I definitely want to have. But so I guess, like, you know, going into that line of having success with Nami, so winning games and obviously, you know, you started having that success at locals and you maybe slowly started looking at bigger prizes in your eyes, right? Yeah. So whether that be regionals or offline tournaments or everything, and you started participating in them, and without going too far into your results and everything, I think a lot of folks watching this video know that you are a successful Nami player in many ways. So how do you feel like, before we go into those results, what do you feel like are some good prep tips for Nami? Is it playing a bunch of games? Is it working on certain combos? Is it just mind grinding the sim for like 4 hours a day? Like what does that look like for you for success with the deck?
I mean, I definitely know it's different from every person, but this is going to be really funny. Both the regionals I've attended have been on 3 or less hours of sleep. It's been after not touching the game for about a fortnight.
Okay.
And just the cards believing in my own ability.
Okay, so we have the classic, you know, Pharaoh cheating in there, right? Like, I don't know how, like, if you watch the Yu-Gi-Oh! Finale, I don't know how a layman human being fought the biggest cheater known in TCG, the Pharaoh, who literally, the heart of the cards is literally just top decking exactly what you need. So I'm happy you were able to channel that energy, if that's interesting. Yeah. But hey, I think
playing the game too much leading up to them regionals, like on the day of them regionals, I'm just gonna hate being there almost.
Fair enough.
Like, I'm just gonna be like, oh, I played this for so long, I don't want to be here. It's just like, I'd rather just turn up and be like, oh, I haven't played this in a while, I'm gonna have fun playing this.
So I'm so happy you brought that up, like changing your mentality around it, right? Like, it maybe feeling like, you know, so you put in so much practice that you're putting so much pressure on yourself. You're thinking of like all these things that you have to do, like, oh, I have to sequence this way, or like, I'm going to lose the game. But giving yourself that break, I mean, kind of making it feel like maybe like a bigger locals or something, like, I haven't played this deck in a week, but locals coming up in a few days. Let's do it. Let's leave it up and let's go. So kind of having that fresh feeling, even if you are on like 3 hours of sleep, though.
Yeah.
Which is crazy.
No, with the regionals, I only just attended last weekend. Like, I only got my ticket the day before.
How did you get a regionals ticket the day before? That wasn't sold out? Like, how did you get that?
It was sold out, but our waiting lists clear up so quickly.
Okay.
Like, I don't know what people do. I feel like they just... it gets to like the day before or like the week before the event, and just so many tickets get refunded.
Yeah.
It's like that weekend, there was both the One Piece and Dragon Ball regionals. So Saturday, One Piece, Sunday, Dragon Ball. And I got off the waiting list for both events.
Nice. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I feel like maybe this is like a bias view. I feel like the game definitely has a, on average, like a lot younger crowd. Like, coming from Magic, I find the spread is pretty wide. Like, there's a lot of older players, there's a lot of younger players, but I think kind of that middle-aged type of age. And I feel like things can be more dynamic. A lot of folks are in school, or the type of jobs you're at might be a little bit more dynamic. So maybe that's what's playing into it. Like, people just have dynamic schedules. Heck, it could be scalpers. Can you scalp these tickets? I don't know. I don't know if you can purchase and scalp them, but...
I mean, saying that with like the different jobs, definitely at our locals, like we have teachers, we have psychologists, we have doctors, like we even just have like your average construction worker.
Yeah.
Or like me, I just do a normal warehouse job.
Yeah. But it's like the hours are maybe not as natural or whatever. Like it's like you're not able to attend locals. Maybe during the week. I mean, when do you go to locals, actually? Consider your hours. Like, are you a weekend localer? Like, are you going after work for a late night one, like during the regular week? Or
Definitely a weekend person.
Yeah.
Just because my regular sleeping hours are from like 3 till 12 at night.
Yeah.
I just get home, eat, watch anime for like 3 or 4 hours and just rinse and repeat.
Honestly, it sounds like a beautiful life. And you get some locals on the weekend too. But yeah, okay. Ooh. So I guess like kind of making these bigger tournaments feel a lot more casual, and I would highly recommend everyone get your sleep in. Okay. This is Lenore, who has the mental fortitude and the experience to do this. As a fresh Nami player, don't do this to yourself. Okay. You don't have the knowledge that Lenore does. Okay. You're not that. Okay. You're not that guy. You're not that girl. You're not that person. Okay. Yeah. You got to practice to get there. Yeah.
Helps having the tism a little bit to help you out.
Everyone's on the scale in some way, shape, or form. Take advantage of it, right? Whether that be, you know, a better ability to focus, a better ability to like cue into something, use it. So I guess with that in mind, I wanted to talk about some of the results you've had. So the top finishes that you've had, and maybe just like your experiences around it, and then we can go into some of the matchups. So I guess What are some, especially in those wins, heck, we can even talk about some losses as well. Like, what are some of your MVP cards, the cards that overperform for you that maybe you're always looking for, especially in a mulligan, or you're really excited to see in your hand? Like, what are these cards that really work for you in the deck? I mean, talk about 05, talk about 06, maybe 07 if you have some sim experience. Go for it.
I mean, I will mulligan for a peel off.
Oh,
that is like what I
that's
like
an interesting
to
one. Okay.
I know. I've heard so many people are like, oh, I don't want to peel off in hand early on, but I'm like, just one.
I'm just okay with just one, but it never ends up being just one. Maybe that's the RNG gods trying to hurt me, but it never ends up being just one.
No, just if I see one peel off, I am so happy that makes my game.
Okay. Okay. I mean, I see the merit. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but I guess it's just a way to like refuel. Like, you feel like you don't have to take advantage of triggers to draw more cards or Deathwing to draw more cards. So I see that. My feeling is like, if I see Pilaf, card number two better be Gavel. I don't know. Like that's my feeling. Like, card number two better be Gavel. If I start seeing some Love Mellows or some White Snakes with a Pilaf, I might just want to throw my hand in the garbage. Like, I don't know. Like, but
yeah, no. Oh, did you see my recent Twitter post from the regionals I attended last week? If you go have a quick look on that, see a starting hand, which had.
Let me see. Everyone listening to this, by the way, this tweet is going to be linked down below. So we're not going to show it on screen right now, but it will be linked down below. I'm going to try my best to describe it as well. Okay, how far back is it? It's a recent tweet?
Recent, 5 days ago.
I can't do math. So, May 11th.
There's four photos. So
is this the Mr. One hand?
Yeah.
What? Okay, to everyone listening, this is a hand. Okay, three Mr. Ones, two Gravity Blades, and one Desert Spawn.
I was to just like say GG there.
So you mulligan into this, I'm assuming. Like, you were forced to keep this. I don't know. I don't know. I might have just scooped and gone to side events at that point. This was at local. Sorry. I might have just scooped and gone to side events. I don't know how to, like, seeing a two Gravity Blades in my opening hand, I would have been like, I'm losing this game. This is it. They're going to play, my opponent's going to register like Whitebeard against me, and I'm going to cry. What do I do with this hand? The opponent? Who was the opponent?
It was a Sakazuki. So,
I guess the Gravity Blades eventually work, but how do you get there?
In all honesty, I didn't use them once during the event.
That's crazy. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, it was just like, I had a few triggers and I was like, oh, the trigger's awesome. In my hand, it just feels like this brick.
No. But I just want to point out, you won this one.
No, I dropped this. I dropped it hard.
Oh, I'm reading the check marks wrong. Sorry. Okay, I'm reading the check marks wrong.
So this was round four.
Yeah. This was the round four.
I dropped both my Sakazuki games that day. I think both hands were just horrendous.
I think Sakazuki's one of those matchups, in my opinion, that really comes down to triggers. Like, I found that like at least 2 to 3 of your triggers need to draw you cards, or you'll never have enough resources. Because eventually they're gonna play Moria. Their board's going to be full. It feels like playing against RP Law. Like, if they're just swinging all this nonsense at you, and they always have the cards they need.
If I'm remembering this game properly, which I think I am, my opponent had three Marios on board at the end. And I was just sat there, just slowly just, yeah, I can counter out of that one. Oh, 12K?
People look at Nami players and they're like, oh, the soccer matchup is 50-50. Why are you losing? But they don't know what we've been through. They don't know about the the three Morias on field. They don't know how you lost to a brand new swing. Like, they don't know about these things, right? They don't know about the struggle, right? Like, Oh Lord! Like people look at me, and we can talk about this matchup. But like I feel like a lot of times I lose to the green yellow matchup, the Yamato matchup. It's just Zoro. Like for some reason they Tekken 10 cost Zoro, and I'm sitting here like, okay, I got three white snakes. GG, next game. All right, you win. Like my bad. I didn't know you had. Pay 10 Dawn, win the game versus Nami, teched into your deck that easy, but okay. They don't know. They just see the matchup and they say, ah, you're an average player. No! Three Boreas is insane! That's crazy.
No.
So, it was, I mean, the first couple of rounds went really well for you. Reiju, Moria, Law. Yeah?
Yeah, the Law one, I was surprised I got. Because I'd had just a horrid run against RP Law at locals before then. And yeah, having that round three win definitely helped.
I mean, let's hop right into it. Like, honestly, let's talk about some matchups. How do you feel about the red-purple Law matchup? I mean, you feel like yourself, like you had a bad run against it, but I mean, are you supposed to have a good run against it? I mean, give me the wisdom here. Like,
I mean, RP Law is just a horrible deck to play against. Just the fact that it has the blocker Law, built-in bottom decking, and just, I'm never getting a Zeph to hit.
Yeah.
Like, a Zeph is never hitting. If a Zeph hits, something's wrong.
Yeah.
Like, something is very wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, like they're really far behind, there's no cost reduction, or like... something, you're right. Like I had a RP Law player at locals tell me that they try to like reason with me, like they thought I was like getting salty, but I was just like, I was like no, I understand this match was bad, and they're trying to tell me that, like, you know, this match is very winnable for you if you sequenced it right. And I'm like, okay, see, now I'm mad. Now see, now you're lying to me. Now you you're lying to me now, right? Because you're right, it has to go wrong. I feel like the matchup is really hard. And with that being said, what do you feel like are, like, what are some things that you do, if you have any, that you feel like give you an edge in that matchup? Is there a sequencing? Like, is there cards that you maybe save or use early? Like, what are some things you feel like you do that give you an edge?
That is the game I would like to use Gravity Blade. Because most of their stuff doesn't get over 5.
Right.
Whitesnake is the GOAT in that matchup. Yes. Because they normally only want to swing 5. But if I have a Whitesnake in hand, I'm just going to say, nah, you're overcommitting. Like, every swing this turn, you're going to have to overcommit.
Yeah. You start, and like, Whitesnake's really powerful that way, right? Like, you counter out 1 5K attack, but all of a sudden, everything else costs more, and then the Dawn starts really, like, piling away, right? Like, Whitesnake kind of forces them into this scenario where they're having to use their leader ability to play cards because they have to use their Dawn to attack, which is good. Which is good. You don't want to give them more opportunities to play stuff out. But yeah, and do you find, like, so we already talked about how Zeph feels like it never hits. Do you play Zeph? Is it kind of like Sakazuki where maybe you're using Zeph to counter out more? Like what are you looking for character-wise to play out?
I mean, thinking back to that red-purple Law matchup, the Zeph actually won me the game.
Oh, shit.
Purely for the bouncing back.
Oh, okay, fair enough, yeah.
Just the bounce back, mill 2, play Kaya again, that was, yeah.
Okay, fair enough. Okay,
that's all I needed.
A little bit of classic Nami got you there. How do you feel about, I guess maybe red-green Law, like a counterpart? A lot of people have, you know, back and forth about, I know Law players have back and forth about which deck is better into the meta or whatever. I think both are pretty horrendous, but.
We actually had someone who was just mostly playing red-green Law for like the longest time. They were playing it through 05, I think a little bit into 06, I might be wrong. But, no, I think the same thing again. Whitesnake is like your best friend into that matchup again.
Yeah.
Because I feel like it's just a lot of 5K swings again.
Yeah. No, I think end of turn is just been just the biggest boon for us. Like the best thing to happen for a really long time. And I think that's the thing that everyone was missing. Everyone, I mean, translation errors happen all the time. I think when the card was revealed, everyone's like, this is end of turn. End of battle. No way end of turn is a thing, but card's really good. Unconditional draw as well. Let's hop into some other matchups here. So how do you feel about, let's call it as a color in general, yellow. So I'm going to kind of group in NL and Katakuri into one. How do you feel about yellow?
The easiest thing I've ever played against if they don't find more than three big moms.
More than one. In my opinion, you got two big moms out. That's huge. I don't know.
Yeah.
At least it's not search. Well, I guess it is searchable, but like, do you find that there are some, like, because it's generally accepted as an easy matchup for Nami players, like, what do you feel like are some things that might be some mistakes to do in that matchup? If you feel like there are some kind of big glaring ones, like maybe it's not playing Zeph or not using certain counters one. Do you feel like there's any big mistakes that Nami players could be holding them back with against those yellow matchups?
I feel like taking life too quickly.
Yep.
Because you're scared that, oh, that 10 mom's going to come down and take that life almost. Mm-hmm. So it's just like, just thinking, I've just not got to worry about that. I've got so much other life. Mm-hmm. Just one's not going to be the end of the world.
Right. I couldn't agree more. Honestly, I couldn't agree more. I think a lot of the early advice I received when I first started playing 04, 05 was take the hits because then Big Mom has no effect. I'm like, see, that doesn't make sense to me because Big Mom will then hit me. Right? Like, how do I... Yeah. Like, I'm at zero life. Big Mom puts me to zero. They add 10 Dawn to it. Like, how do I counter out a 22? Like, I don't know. Like, I feel like... I don't know. Like, I just... I couldn't agree more. I just feel like a lot of the advice I received early was wrong. And it definitely... Like, I definitely started gaining more points against yellow once I started just countering out of things early and then taking hits late to draw into things. What about... Like, I know they're different because NL doesn't have Big Mom. NL plays kind of closer to the ground, more rush characters. How do you feel about that matchup?
It's another pretty simple matchup. Like you said, they normally stay pretty low to the ground. Mm-hmm. I think yellow just relies so heavily on its triggers.
Yes.
That just some games I'll never swing life.
I feel like every time I hear ban discourse on yellow, it's like half Big Mom and half triggers. It's like that's like half the discourse of like what they both have. I don't know. You tell me if you play other decks. I play nothing but Nami. I have like no concept of what it is. I remember when I first started attacking with like Crocodile and I'm like, what is this? I have to think about so much here when I attack. This is too hard.
No, I think I do have my second deck.
What do you play? What's the leader?
Guess. I'm a Nami player. I like events.
Not Dofi. It's gotta be blue.
Do you want a hint?
Yeah.
It's 01.
Ivankov?
Ivankov's 02.
Oh, see, now I'm bad with this. Okay, give me the card.
Crocodile.
Oh, but blue purple.
Yeah.
Okay, I was going to say, like, blue crocodile doesn't play. I don't think it's like a necessarily event heavy list, but okay.
This other deck is like my little pet deck, and it is horrible. It is a terrible deck, but I like bringing it out now and then.
Are a lot of the events like the same? I haven't played against the matchup too much and I don't have much experience. Okay, I played a bunch against blue crocodile, like the starter deck crocodile. Definitely not definitely a good matchup for Nami. But yeah. how do you feel about like this Crocodile list? Like different aspects of blue, I guess.
Yeah, no. I think the thing I hate about this list or this deck or like 01 blue in general is that they leader locked the Missile Sunday. The 3-drop blocker on KO, grab an event from trash to hand. There are so many other things that could be leader locked.
Okay, all right, look. Bandai. Oh, wow. Lord. Cowards.
Why?
Cowards. No, that's such a sick trigger. Like a dead trigger.
Okay, yo, if your leader has the Baroque Works type, lame.
Cowards. All you Nami haters in the comments. Oh, I'm so mad. That's such a good KO effect. Oh, I can return my Death Wings. That's such a good KO effect. Okay. Okay, I'm not mad. I'm fine. I'll recover. Okay.
We need a an event to give Nami leader Baroque Works tag.
We're gonna pin this discussion. This is gonna clue into the purple discussion. We're gonna pin this. We're coming back to this. This is a part of the purple discussion. Okay, back to matchups. We're gonna pin that one. We talked a little bit about Sakazuki. How do you feel about Sakazuki in 06? Very different from 05. Get access to some new things. Let's kind of finish off that discussion. How are you feeling about Sakazuki in 06?
Are we thinking before or after the ban? Is 06 before ban? Or does it get banned?
After ban. After ban, I think. Sorry. 06, current Sakazuki. So, like, before it gets, like, kind of butchered. Oh.
I don't mind it if they don't play Pudding.
Oh, God. If they don't play Gion, you mean? Pudding is fine. I've had experience against Dofi, but if they don't play Gion is the reason I've stopped playing the Sim Ranked, because people will see like the old iteration of Sim Ranked. I'm not have you played a lot of Sim Ranked?
No, I don't really touch the Sim much.
Fair enough. That's a discussion I want to pin for later as well. But what with the current or the old implementation of the Ranked was you would queue into like a Discord queue. And then you would hop into like a separate Discord chat. That's your quote unquote lobby. But then people would see your leader. And I've had like a couple of situations where people will pause. They won't join my private lobby on the Sim. They'll pause, which in my mind is them editing their deck. Add 4 Geons because it's a Navy type card and searchable by Tashigi. So that's their, their justification. I'm like, no, you're cheating. Don't lie. You saw me queue in with Nami. You went in, changed your deck, then joined my lobby. You're lying. I hate Gion.
Yeah, no. I mean, I could have possibly had that experience with a Sakazuki player here in Australia, because I, in my first online regionals, round 6, I was going in 5-0. So okay. I'm winning.
Yeah,
I'm doing good.
Yeah.
So I get matched up with a gentleman that was playing Sakazuki.
Okay.
And he just found everything. Like, I'm talking them. Oh, it's like that weird 3-drop blue ulti that on attack bottom decks something. I'm like, what Sakazuki list runs that? ?
It's like the 5% of me wants to be a neutral party and be like, oh, maybe they're cooking for 5 rounds, and then the other 95% is like, burn the witch! Burn the witch, that's not a good card.
Yeah.
Okay, alright, no comment,
In like the first 10 cards of your deck, you see 4 Houndblazers, some Borsalinos. I'm like, oh yeah, that's cool.
And they probably started hitting you with, I don't know when you had this online regionals, but there's the other bottom decking card that they play now where they bottom deck a 1-cost and a 2-cost. And it's like a 2-cost event.
Amaru?
Something like that. Yeah, it starts with an A. And they probably had like 50 of those as well. 4 Houndblades off the top 10 is garbage. I would have called a judge. Like, I'm not saying you should. I'm saying, like, me, I would have gotten so salty. I'd be like, I need a deck check. Judge, come here and look at this deck. I need a deck check. That's insane.
And, like, I believed his deck because after the game, we were straightway deck checked.
Okay.
Like, a judge came in and did both of us because I think they just did that with the top 64.
Makes sense. Okay. That's good practice. Yeah.
But he was the gentleman where the Great Eruption magically went off screen. Incoming Tuka Kana. It was that fellow.
We're going to pin this discussion as well, because I don't want to get into a rant about cheaters right now and the solution to this. But I've been screaming to the moon about cheaters for too long. I'm going to ignore that because that's going to get me mad. Okay. Sakazuki cheaters. Okay, that's just summarize the general populace of Sakazuki players. Derogatory purposefully. I hate y'all sometimes. But Yamato, how do you feel about that matchup? Double attack built into a leader.
It's grotty, especially because of her secondary leader effect.
Yes.
Like, opponent to a less life, just add 2 rested Don.
Yes.
Okay, 10k Horty Joan hit, and you've still got
Tap down your 2 Don, go bye-bye Deathwing, and then swing at you for 10k. Yes, yes, absolutely disgusting. Yes.
And I'm like, oh yeah, that's cool. And then there's the Onamis.
This is, okay, this is why I remember, okay, this isn't calling him out, but Nikaido, this is one thing I can't get behind. He told me in this matchup, you should be taking the hits early, which I understand the baseline merit, because you take the hits early, you have more resources to counter out of the Onami attacks later. You know why I don't believe this? Literally the second ability on Yamato. I am not giving them 2 Dawn on characters for free. This is why I don't believe it. I don't want to take these hits early. That sounds like garbage advice, but that's not anything against Nikaido personally. Just that specific piece of advice, I think, is bad faith. My opinion only. So take it with a grain of salt. But
no, for sure. If I'm playing against Yama, I'm avoiding the early hits as much as I can.
Yeah.
Especially if it was weird. It wasn't a regionals, it was a locals like a few weeks before. But I had someone like swing. They played an Onami on their 3 Dawn turn and they were like, oh, 5k double attack banish. And I'm like, are you sure? What?
Okay.
I mean, I'm gonna counter out of this.
Yeah.
You know that, right?
Here's one event to stop your insane resource swing that you just gave up, but okay. Okay, all right.
Yeah, it was, it was funny.
I think a lot of people forget as well, and I do want to touch on this moment as well. People be like, oh, you played against a bad Yamato player. Like, of course you're going to get free wins. I think, look, just as much as us as Nami players make misplays in the eyes of all the YouTube comments and the Twitter haters, right? Like, hindsight is 20/20 for everyone. Apparently all the people in the comments can tell the future and know how to play perfectly. So as much as we're allowed to make mistakes, our opponents are as well. Not every opponent can play perfectly. And so in a perfect world, just as many mistakes as we might make, just as many amazing plays as we might make, we have to expect the same from our opponent. So it's perfectly okay if our opponents make mistakes like this, but we are allowed to make fun of them for it. So
exactly.
We are allowed to make fun of them for it.
As my high school teacher once told me, it's not bullying if it only happens once.
Onami on 3 Dawn is absolutely wild. You deserve to get clapped for that one. Okay. Yamato, so that's fair, kind of avoiding those hits early. I completely agree. After that, it's just about how many Hody Jones they have, in my opinion. But what about some of the other matchups? I'm gonna kind of group them together. Just in my experience, I haven't come across them as much. I feel like the flavor of the day, especially on the sim, is a little different. So it might be a little polarizing, the matchups I'm gonna group together, but Perona, Moria, and Reiju.
Yeah.
very different, but I'm just going to group them together. I feel like in my personal experience, I haven't run across them in a great enough significance to mention them together or individually, but Perona, Moria, and Reiju.
Perona, I haven't run up against much either. Mm-hmm. I know how to play into the matchup, but it just doesn't seem like a deck people are wanting to play almost. Like, it's almost like,
I agree.
Why play Perona when you can play Sakazuki and now you have access to all these blue navy cards?
Yeah. Or like, if you're playing it for green, just play like Yamato or something. I don't know. You just have the double attacker. Play the film package with what's her name? Yeah, just play the film deck. Like, I just feel like that deck example, like, you have restand effects, like, you have like good search effects. Like, I feel like it just does green like perfectly. But I agree. Perona, yeah.
Yeah, no. I would almost clump Uta into that same, like, not really worth talking about package. Yeah. I feel like Uta as a deck can be awesome. Like, I saw it came top 16 both here and in... Was there a regionals in the States?
Yeah, there was. There was a big one. I'm forgetting the One Piece creator I was following for this, but there was one that I think it was a top 8. If not a top placement, but it was cool to see the film package go off, because I mean, it cheats out a lot of stuff. It searches really well. It's a highly synergistic deck. I understand like the appeal to it. It's a deck that like really builds itself.
Yeah, I feel like in that almost builds itself deck, I would say Whitebeard is in there as well.
God, I hate that deck. It's so like,
what do you mean, bro? You play pudding on them and they just cry.
If okay, I played okay, all right, fine, 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 fine. Yes, the tech is there. I understand. It's just like, I see why the deck was banned. I see why this deck was like, that's why. I absolutely. Coming into the game like really late, you've had a lot of experience playing the game early, especially and what I would consider like pretty early in the game as well. But I just, you know, coming into the latter half of that and having Marco, I believe it was banned out of that and one out of card.
Yeah.
I just...
Marco, Whitebeard.
I think Moby Dick as well.
Moby Dick was permabanned along with our beautiful boy, Kabaji. Oh.
That's a separate discussion as well. Yes. Sorry.
Scared to unban that card. I want it back.
Hey, but that's a discussion we're pending for later. I have four discussions I have to remember to come back to. but I think it's just like, I hate Whitebeard because I just don't understand how this deck was allowed to be around for so long. I think it's like the exemplification of the poor design choices that Bandai has made for this game. I think that deck exemplifies the lack of ability of Bandai to do much in this game. I think purple exemplifies that now in 08 from what we're getting. I think the leader locking in blue is also horrendous as well. There's a couple of things in this game that really frustrate me once they all come together, but Whitebeard is one of them.
Yeah, I mean, we had a lovely lad in our locals just come out of nowhere, and he came 7th with Whitebeard, and I was like, I genuinely forgot this deck was a thing. Like, I thought it was past its use by date, but then seeing two Whitebeard players in the top 16, I was like, oh damn, I need to like learn this matchup again.
It's like I have someone at locals that kind of never let it go. They have max rarity Whitebeard, and the deck still kicks. Like if your opponent misses on, like, there's Sakazuki players and Moria players, but if they miss on removal like one turn, the deck runs away with it, right? Like, it's like there's a lot of removal in the meta right now. There's a lot of blockers. There's a lot of good triggers as well, but if your opponent misses, they miss. Like, that's just kind of what you sign up for. The majority of the time you will miss, in my opinion. So the deck is insane. How do you feel about, I guess, on a different angle of aggro, the Reiju matchup?
I'm fine as long as I remember that the judge taps a Don. I kept forgetting that when judge comes down, he taps one Don.
Oh.
And that would sometimes lose games.
Yeah. Okay, I see what you mean.
So,
yeah.
Just like constantly remembering that, okay, this fella's going to come down. He's going to tap one of my Don. So if I see a Reiju player attacking and they've got 7 open, or 8 open, I should say, I'm like, okay, Judge is coming down. Before he does, I'm dumping my hand.
Right, using as much as possible, and then like maybe you just kind of take the hit or whatever off that afterwards. Yeah. That's good. Yeah, just making a value proposition. I don't have too much experience against a matchup either. It's cool. Like they get to cheat out like a lot of big things early. Some of them have rush, which is kind of frustrating. But I find that like it's one of those matchups where Nikaido's list with Crocs is pretty uniquely placed because they get empty handed pretty well. They play the Kaias too. So there's a lot of card disadvantage in the deck, so they don't have a lot to counter out of. And I find that purple right now is pretty much like you have a 2K counter or your cards don't counter at all, which is kind of nice. I find like that's how the decks are built. Go on.
It's almost why I hated when when Odin was announced, the red green Odin, all of characters suddenly get a counter power. So many people, my locals, started raving about that, and I'm like, you'd rather have a 2K counter though, wouldn't you?
Right.
You wouldn't. You would just run 2K counters, right?
Yeah, I feel like Odin players now, there's like a cheeky little like almost one shot combo in the deck. I think it's like you can restand a character like 3-4 times or something, and like it's swinging at you for like 8 or 9. It's like you need like 3 cards to set it up. But I think that's primarily the reason to be playing like Odin right now.
Yeah,
I think it's like a fun little homebrew deck, but there's a cheeky like again almost one shot combo in it. I think that's about it. It's pretty niche, but yeah, I understand. Odin's not, yeah.
Restanding events should not have been a thing. I'm like, yeah, you're tapped out. Woo, no more attacks. Suddenly, yes, let me restand.
Yeah, green's got to have an identity, I guess. And I guess that's what it is. Whether or not they're balancing it right, I don't know. The last matchup I want to talk about is Moria. Kind of the deck to come out of 06, the big new one, like really an effect that we haven't seen before. We're talking about kind of green having recursion and blue having a lot of events, and red having aggro, black having not just removal, but trash recursion. How do you feel about this matchup?
I feel like Bandai just looked at Magic and they were like, reanimate. This is cool.
Yeah. Like when I first saw the leader, I felt the same way. I was just like, isn't this like the most busted leader like ever? Like this is the only card that like has this effect. This is insane. And you get to play Akos Moria as well. So I just it feels like again the deck just builds itself, but also I hate Perona. Like that four, that's a dumb card. Okay, I'm on the draw. I'm at 6 cards in hand. I'm probably not playing something out, right? Even if I play something out, it's a Mr. One and a Recurs One. Doesn't matter. I'm probably not playing something out. I'm at 5 cards. That Perona will always be in the Moria's trash. It will always come down, take a card out of my hand. That card sucks. I hate the fact that its marker is 5 cards in hand. That card sucks.
I don't know. Which one do you hate more, the Perona or the Block of Law?
No, I hate Perona. I think that's the card that always screws me over. It always screws me over. And it's like, to me, in my games, it's been like an unseen value of I always have to enter these games one card down. Like, I've come across it, and maybe it's just, like, my RNG, where I've come across this so many times, but I feel like I always have to be one card down against this matchup, which is why it frustrates me. So,
would you consider putting 3K Worlds back in your deck just for that one card?
Wait,
3,000 Worlds.
That's the bottom deck of 5 costs or less?
Yeah. Just to stop the recursion of it.
Honestly, so I'm not mad at 3K. I kind of just like Gravity Blade now.
Mm.
Like, I don't mind waiting an extra turn and just doing it like two of them. So I just like it's not bad. The Gravity Blade's pretty sick. I don't know. Like I've been playing it a lot more recently. I like Gravity Blade. So yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So I'm not mad at 3,000. Gravity Blade's kind of sick. So I'd rather just play that. Mm. But yeah, that's how I feel about the Moria matchup.
Yeah.
Is there anything specific that you find that I feel like Moria is a matchup? I mean, I still struggle with it personally. Mm. I don't know how you feel about it, but is there maybe a specific strategy or kind of like a line of play that you try and work with? Like, again, this is one of those things where I've heard a couple of Nami players tell me, Nikaido as well, tell me that they, you know, like Bebo or Ramtins told me this as well, that kind of the top 8 Nami player. They told me, you know, be as proactive as possible until Moria comes down. Like, just use your Dawn, which I don't know. That deck like floods board like really quick. Like, it really does. So I don't know, what's your take on it?
I mean, I definitely agree with that. Because yeah, like you said, it floods board so quickly.
Yeah.
And just suddenly having like one character go to 3, suddenly 5.
Yeah.
In the span of like 2 turns, like with 8 Dawn on Moria, you get like what, 15 Dawn worth of value?
Yeah. It like astronomical value. Technically, I feel like it's like more. It's not even like 15 Dawn. Like, it's like, cause then you have to account for the effects too. Like they return 15 Dawn, they return like a Perona, discard a card out of your hand, and then play brand new, like tutor up another card, feed their yard even more. Like, it's like it feels like 20 plus Dawn worth of value. That's coming down. Like, I don't know. Like, it feels astronomical.
Mm.
But yeah, like, do you feel like it's a removal heavy matchup? Like, how do you feel about Zeph in this matchup?
Good if you see it early.
Sure.
If they've developed board, then I
just a 1K counter.
Yeah, literally. Okay, fair enough. It's why Zeph's now a 2-of in my deck.
Yeah.
Because I found I wasn't playing him enough.
Yep.
And I'd rather something with a trigger like the Gravity Blade.
Yep. Yeah. 3, I mean, its trigger is literally 3,000 worlds, so
yeah,
it's really good.
It's better than 3,000 worlds, actually.
Oh yeah, because 3,000 bounces are no.
3,000 bottoms are 3 of. Red Rock bottoms a 4 drop, Gravity Blade bottoms a 5.
Oh, sorry, we're talking about like the triggers themselves. Sorry, what I meant was like this. So the trigger of Gravity Blade is the front side of 3,000. That's what I meant. Yeah. It's the front side of 3,000, which is pretty nice. Mm. But yeah, I think I agree. I've been really appreciating playing the removal heavy builds that I think like if you weren't around, like I think in the Twitter sphere, like pushing this as well, I definitely wouldn't have gone down this removal heavy route. That's not an avenue I would have explored. I would have just written off Red Rock a lot. I would have written off Gravity Blade as well. So I appreciate you pushing this as well. When that's kind of why I want to talk about individual card choices right now. Before we head into some kind of general discussion, I want to talk about some individual cards. You've kind of given me your opinions about Zeph a little bit, but I want to talk about them more. Speak the good name of Zeph or speak its downfall. What's your choice?
I don't know. Because in some games it is damned if you do and damned if you don't.
I'm going to take this clip and I'm going to clip it on Twitter. I'm going to quote you on it infinitely. No.
Damn. I genuinely think in the right situation, he is the best card in your deck.
Mm-hmm.
If you can drop them against yellow early, if you can drop them against Moria early, do not play him against Sakazuki. You are stupid.
Don't use 5 Dawn for nothing to mill 2 cards, right?
Literally, just in the right matchup, Zeph's the best thing that can happen to your deck.
Yeah.
By just taking a chunk of it and flipping it upside down.
Yeah.
And this is where probably me and Nikaido will differ. I've tried his crocodile thing. Not for me.
Right. It's
like
it's very different. I still don't understand it as well. I don't know. Maybe it's like how I'm drawing, but I don't get it as well.
Yeah. Like he can cook on the other side of the water with his little Kiwi fellows with his crocodiles.
Yeah.
But I just think, I feel like Zeph's always going to be in the deck almost. Or he always needs to be in that deck to apply some sort of pressure against matchups where they think, oh, I'm up against Nami. This is going to be so easy.
Right.
Where suddenly it's then play a Zeph and it's like, oh, this thing is going to attack me.
Where are my blockers? Exactly. Right. Like, where are my blockers type of thing?
Go on. I feel like, playing Nami, a lot of like your Sakazuki decks, your Marias, your yellow decks, they won't play their blockers against you, mm-hmm. even when they have it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, sure, sometimes they'll play, like, the decks that have access to black will play the Sabo for the draw engine, the draw two, drop one?
Yeah, five costs, draw five costs, you get a Kaya effect, and then your cards can't be KO'd by effects.
Like, I feel like if I play a Zeph, I'm forcing them to play a blocker. I'm forcing them to take a turn to basically say, okay, I have to deal with this, or I'm going to get so much advantage with this.
No, it forces them to play in a different way. And I think that's like really valuable too, right? Even if it gets removed, like, okay, if you're playing against Sakazuki, like you mentioned, you're taking it out. You're doing yourself a disservice. But in almost like other matchups, like you have to force them to have like just the bottom deck, the removal, like whatever it might be. And they have to play it differently. They're using Dawn slightly differently. They're ordering things differently. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an underrated part about Zeph. I think you're right. Like, you're playing two of them, but you have to play him because it feels like without him, like, you're losing so many percentage points against certain matchups that, like, you just can't at all. So you're right. I think even as a two of, it's very valuable to have. I think it's smart as well to tech and maybe play him as a two of as well. I think that's really smart. Make room for what you feel like is more valuable to you in the deck against your metagame, whatever it might be. I think that's smart.
Definitely. I mean, I took him down to a four of so I could put Gravity Blade as a four.
Yep.
Or took him down to a two, Gravity to a four. Sure, Gravity Blade hurt me some games, as you saw in that Twitter post. But
I've been meaning to try out four Gravity Blade because of some recent talks about it. I was trying out like something similar to what you were doing previously. I was doing two Red Rocks, two Gravity Blades. Really, really love Gravity Blade. I can see it being a problem as a four of, but it's a great trigger too. And just Red Rock, okay. In paper, I may play one Red Rock, but like I feel like on the sim, people are doing some garbage. They're doing some nonsense on the sim. And anyway, Red Rock.
Playing them Zoros.
Yeah, they're doing some nonsense. So
it's the reason my deck changes in 07.
Mm-hmm.
I am putting Red Rock very swiftly back in this deck because Bonnie plays four Secret Zoros. And I am not about to have that.
Oh, God, I don't even want to hear that. That gave me a headache. Like, you gave me a migraine just listening to that. Oh, God.
Yeah, no, because I had a friend post on... Where's his post? On Twitter. And he reposted a Bonnie deck. And I look at the bottom of the deck and I'm like, oh, yeah, four Doffies. Four Zoros.
Yeah.
Looks like fun, bro.
Yeah, I bet you're having fun. Yeah, oh, my characters are frozen and you can restand like 50 times. I bet you're having a lot of fun over there. Yeah. That's one of those decks where I feel like I remember this like turning point for me. There was a game that I had against yellow and it just blew my mind that it was this simple and they beat me. And it was like, they started just going, they said they played Big Mom, took my life, didn't swing. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
And then they did it again. Big Mom, didn't swing. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
And then I started understanding what they were doing. They're trying to build a board and alpha swing me, which is what these decks want to do. These Zoro decks want to do.
That's what I've been trying to tell everyone at locals. Just build a board.
Yeah.
Don't swing.
Yeah.
Just one-shot me.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And that is your best option.
And then just rely on... Because, like, with the introduction of Whitesnake, the triggers have been, like, a lot worse. Like, in my opinion, like in a vacuum, Whitesnake's trigger is worse than Deathwing's trigger. And I say... And I'm comparing it to Deathwing because a lot of folks are hopping off of Deathwing. Going into 07, sometimes in 06 as well. A lot of folks are trying to stray away from it. And I think, like, in general, without the ability of Buggy now to find your Deathwing. So already Deathwing's just, like, not a searchable card anymore. And then, like, you have more White Snakes in your triggers now. Like, I feel like the triggers are getting worse in Nami, which is kind of where I want to take this discussion a little bit. How do you feel about, like, the deck building in Nami right now? You're playing a more removal-heavy build. I think the list that you play, the triggers are amazing. I definitely lean towards what you're doing versus other lists that I'm seeing in other creators. I definitely lean towards your list. Because I'm a big fan of triggers. I want backups. But how do you feel about, like deck building, the choices that people are making? Feel free to call me out, because I've been having a lot of fun with Ivankov. That is a list. No, oh, Lord. It makes me want to sleeve up Ivankov as a leader, but...
No, I genuinely enjoy watching your videos. Like, seeing things that I wouldn't think of is cool to see. Like, genuinely. But as far as my deck building goes, I won't build a Nami deck with less than 36 triggers. So more than...
I'm doing the math in my head. Sorry, I'm doing the math in my head. That's why I'm like, okay.
More than 3/4 of the deck needs to be a trigger.
Yeah. Okay, so like... 4 Mr. Ones, 4 Kaias, and then you said 36, right? So that's like 14. Yeah. Oh, right. Melo doesn't have a trigger. Right. It doesn't need to just be characters.
The worst card design ever. It's such a good card. It needed a trigger.
Yeah. No, if that card had a trigger, it would have been busted. I will fully concede the fact that that card having a trigger would have been, it would have been like a $30 card. Like,
well, it's so beautiful, though. I want it to have a trigger. It needs a little line of text that just says trigger.
What would the trigger be? If you had to design a trigger for Melo, what would it be?
I feel like it should be, because thinking about like Boa's ability.
Yes.
She freezes people in place.
I'm so happy you took this the logical route. I'm so happy. I feel like if I asked so many other people, they'd be like, this should buff something, or this should draw a card. No. I'm so happy you took the logical route.
It definitely shouldn't be a leader locked ability, because it's just such a good deck, and I feel like so many decks can use it. It's such a like future-proofed card.
Yep.
But I feel like if it did have a trigger, it would be like... I don't know. I feel like it should be like rest something.
Yeah, maybe because rest Boa's something ability. or I mean, I'm thinking of like current Boa leader right now. I think 07, like it cares about things like bouncing. So I'm almost thinking like it should have like a bounce, a one cost or a two cost effect.
Almost like an overheat.
I guess so. Like, I hate the fact that overheat requires an active character. I hate that clause so much.
Why I'm swapping to Snake Dance.
Wait.
Next in 07. Because Snake Dance.
Yeah, that's a current card.
No, that's an 07.
Oh, wait. No, yes. Snake Dance is 2 for a 4K, and then, but you have to bounce something. Like, it's not a main. Yeah. Okay, sorry. It's coming back to me now. Yeah. You have to bounce something. Card's good. I don't blame you.
Let me just pull up the 07 cards, just in case we talk about them.
Yeah. No, the card's good. In terms of, okay, so we kind of had that fun little brewing session with that. I want to talk about some of the other cards individually. You really like Pilaf. You talked about that in the beginning. Kaya, I think, I don't need folks' opinion on Kaya. We're not losing Kaya.
Kaya's Kaya. I mean, I'm so glad she got a winner card.
I hate the fact that different regions have different arts.
I do too. I mean, I think this one was the best. Like with the, have you seen these ones?
Yeah. I like your one better. The other one has like, I think it's like a full artwork. Like there's like a window in the background or something.
I still have two base rarity of these because let me tell you, I have won 6 locals over here with Nami and they've never pulled a winner Kaya. I have had like 3 or 4 of the black card, 2 of the Shihiroshis, 1 of the fishmen.
Yeah.
Where's my Kaya?
Meanwhile, into this meta, I haven't attended a locals at all. I'm sitting here like, and people have been messaging me. They're like, yo, look at my winner Kaya's. I'm like, I hate all of you. And they're like, oh, well, I can't give this to you. I'm a Dofi player. I'm like, burn. Just burn in hell. Go away. I want that card. But I think you're right. I agree with you on the art. I just hate the fact that they're different arts. I'm not a fan. It should have just been one. I think there's too many people. There's a lot of people that like one versus the other. I think we should have just made an executive decision and forced everyone into one. I think we should have made an executive decision. Okay. What about some of the one cost events? You know what? Forget it. One cost events too easy. Talk to me about the characters. Characters.
I want to talk about my Desert Spada.
Okay.
That's my favorite card.
Talk about Desert Spada. You're allowed to talk about Desert Spada. All right, go ahead. Talk to me about bottom decking your cards.
No, I love it genuinely. If my opponent's like bottom deck to Kaya, my first thought is, do I Mr. One a Desert Spada back to hand?
That's like big brain. That's too big brain for me.
Executive decision.
I will tell you what, though. I think one of the parts of my Kaya Nami game that I need to work a lot more on is bottom decking more. I think, and that's one thing I've been trying to focus on personally is like when I see a spread of 3 cards off a Spada trigger, I think I get too caught up in the fact that sometimes I see, like, I'll see a peel off. And I'll tunnel vision into that when the other 2 cards are net negative. Like, it'll be like, like, it's like turn 6 and I see Pilaf into Whitesnake and Mr. One. Like, it's not the most powerful thing. Like, I want Deathwink. I want Gavel. Like, I want better cards than that. I definitely need to, like, and I'm happy you're bringing up the fact that, like, how do you, you know, take a Kaya from the bottom and push it back on top? I need to work on my bottom decking game a lot more. So I'm happy you brought that up. It's definitely a weak point in my game, but Spada, good card.
I like it. It's a good card.
Draw 2 trigger as well. Nice little bonus off the top. Needs an alt art. I mean, hey, all the cards in this deck need an alt art. I'm not going to lie. All of them do. Pilaf? Yo, number one alt art for me, Pilaf.
Oh, fuck. Excuse my French. Let me send you a photo real quick. Oh.
Yeah. Number one alt art for me.
I had a friend custom make me peel off alt arts. Because I was sick of looking at this weird fella just having some
Send it to me. Send it to me on Twitter if you don't mind. Just because we have this on Discord. Yep. Okay. Let me see this.
I've sent it.
I hope you like
it.
So good. So good. For those of you watching this visually or listening to it, whatever, this is they take Sanji from the live action and they just have this beautiful, dreamy side shot of him just like cooking up a storm. So it's definitely like, who knows if he's cooking his pilaf in this. I I think I see a pilaf in there. I think I see some rice on a plate, but who knows if he's cooking his pilaf in there. But Sanji's cooking up a storm. That is a beautiful image. He's got his little chef's towel on his shoulder. My man's looking like a 10. I hear my man's looking like a 10.
Bro, he looks way more than a 10.
Nah, really? This is beautiful. How did your friend do this? Like, how do they apply the treatment on this?
I mean, I think it's almost like he prints like a... It's almost like he prints a sticker.
Oh, that's
smart. And then he puts the sticker on the card because it's an actual card. Do I have them here with me? Let me check the stuff box real quick.
That's cool. Yeah. I think alt arting is probably a big next step for this game after they figure out reprints.
After they figure out that we don't want folders, we want just pretty alt arts in the
set. We don't want boxes with playmats and serialized red Namis. We want actual reprints. Okay, you know what? We'll talk about it in a second. Just let me know if you have your Sanji art. We'll talk about it in a second.
Oh God, where did I put them? Because I took them out of my deck box because I had them in like a side deck.
Yeah.
But I think I have them.
No, it's okay. Here, I'll tell you what. Keep searching. I'll kind of move to my and interrupt me once you find them if you do. But moving into my next section, I want to talk about the One Piece TCG in general and kind of bring together some of the topics we were talking about, because I think the interesting perspective that you have, being a commander player in Magic and just kind of being earlier in the game as well, kind of being around for Nami since the beginning. You know, we've already kind of talked about, you know, the other decks that you play. You have the blue purple crocodile, kind of staying to that blue flavor. What are you, I guess, like looking forward into the One Piece TCG? Because it's still a relatively new game, and I think right now it's a top 5 or 6 TCG out there. The big three: Pokemon, Yu-Gi-Oh, Magic. I think it's up there. I think it's number 5, number 4, maybe.
I mean, I think it wheedles its way into the top 3.
What does it shift out?
I feel like it becomes Magic, Pokemon, One Piece.
Ooh.
Because I feel
all
like
the
Magic
Yu-Gi-Oh players are malding right now. They're so mad. The Pot of Greed players coming out of the woodworks. They're like, I want to, you know what? Exodia won a tournament recently. Yu-Gi-Oh is going through a renaissance. How dare you? I have not a lot of experience with Yu-Gi-Oh, so talk your trash. Talk your smack. I'm here for it.
No, I can't really talk smack because remember at the start I did say I do play a bit of everything, and I do play Yu-Gi-Oh. These are like my beautiful ash blossoms.
Yeah. Okay.
But I play my Yu-Gi-Oh deck is I play Dark Magicians.
Okay.
So I'm not one of them, like, I'm going to find this stupid little combo deck. I'm going to synchro summon this BS into this fusion. I don't know.
In my opinion, like, from an outside perspective, Yu-Gi-Oh! Has become, like, the Hearthstoneification of the physical TCG.
Absolutely.
I feel like Pokemon has almost reached that point, but Pokemon is, like... It's such a unique, like, the way it's played is so unique, and like the way, like, it's very much a fusion of like Japanese or Eastern TCGs and Western TCGs that, like, I think it's held within its parameters, but Yu-Gi-Oh! Has just gone wild. Yu-Gi-Oh! Has just truly become like the let's make anything and work with it. I also hate the fact that like Yu-Gi-Oh! Just forced a different card size. Like, you didn't need to be that edgelord, okay? We could have just made standard size. Like,
I don't understand why they needed to be so difficult.
I don't know. It makes me not want to play the game, knowing that all of my sleeves won't work with the game. It makes me not want to play the game.
My Yu-Gi-Oh deck's triple sleeved.
Hey, my Nami deck is quad sleeved. Haha, there's me one-upping you. Top loaders.
How?
I don't know, big hands. Like it's a tough thing to shuffle. You have to shuffle it in pairs. Like you split the deck in half and then you try and like riffle it a bit. It's for fun. Look, yeah. I have a regular Nami deck. I have two copies of it. If I need to go into like a tournament or like a more serious like competitive REL, I take the regular sleeved one. But for my LGS, I play the quad sleeved.
Bro,
I play the quad.
How sleeved. Big are your hands, bro?
Look, I'm not Shaq. I'm not Shaquille O'Neal. All right, like I can't shuffle the whole thing. It's just a flex thing. It's because it's the only TCG I think that you can get away with this because there isn't a lot of shuffling yet. There isn't a lot of shuffling yet. It's not like Magic where you have fetch lands. It's not Yu-Gi-Oh where you're constantly looking through your deck. I think you can get away with it. So why not? But that might change.
My first main game, I'm allowed to triple sleeve. So I don't think I've talked about my other main game, but I also play Weiss Schwartz.
Oh, that game's still going?
Yeah. My God.
That game's still going? Dude, I've been around like when the Weiss Schwartz thing was like happening, like to my knowledge, so correct me if I'm wrong. To my knowledge, it's like essentially like an anime combo game. Like you get characters from different animes coming in.
Yeah. So I'll show you my main two decks. I'll show you the really pretty signature cards I have for them.
Okay.
But my two main decks are the seven Chainsaw Man. Okay. And Seven Deadly Sins.
Okay.
Yep. Like, I don't know if you can see, like, around here. I'll quickly shuffle my screen this way.
First of all, shout out to the IKEA shelves. Shout out to the IKEA shelves.
These are all play sets of different Weiss Schwartz sets. So
that's insane.
There's, like, Fate Stay Night, Seven Deadly Sins, Fate Apocrypha, Miss Kobayashi Dragon Maid. Such a good anime.
Just like suffice it to say, you like the game a little bit.
Oh, I'm obsessed.
I didn't know the game was still going.
No, the one thing I do hate about the game, and I guess this is a good transition point, but we have to play with official sleeves. What? Like, we can't use, I guess it's called doujin artwork. Like, we have to use licensed, product.
What does that even mean? Wait, so I can't go to Dragon Shield, buy some blank sleeves, and use that?
You can. If you opt to use character sleeves, which I do in all the card games I play, right, because I like to have my waifu on the sleeves.
Right.
Tastefully. Very tasty.
You're gonna make me pin a six discussion for later on, and my brain can't handle all this. All right, yeah.
But no, this is a very quick discussion. But I feel like tasteful sleeves are okay. But I had a friend go to regionals recently, and he had a Nami playmat, and it was of the same artwork you could get like official TCG sleeves in.
Okay.
They were like some really pretty, like, blue. She was holding her, like, staff thing.
Yeah.
And he got asked by a judge to flip it over. And I was like, what?
Okay, so I will say, in your specific scenario, that's pretty garbage, especially in the sense that if it's Bandai licensed and if it's of the artwork of sleeves that are already being designed, fair game. I think that in general, there's too many, especially just being in a male dominated space. I think, and so this is my personal bias of like what I see from Magic versus the One Piece TCG. I know that, and also just being a creator myself, I see a lot of women in the space being a creator. I think as a general player, I would see a lot less women in the space in Magic. So that's my Magic experience. I see a lot of women in the space, a lot of great role models and everything. When it comes to the One Piece TCG, I'm seeing a lot of lack of that. And maybe that's Eastern TCGs in general. A lot of my experience with Yu-Gi-Oh! Is like primarily male-based as well. So I think there's a lot of dummies. That's the word I'm going to use. There's a lot of not-so-savory characters that just want pornography on there.
Is it fair to say simps?
I think, look, you're allowed to enjoy things, you're allowed to like things, but I think there is a fine line. And absolutely. I don't want to go into like mansplaining this whole thing, just like about, you know, the whole, you know, women's rights and like how you kind of showcase something. I just don't think that like there's tasteful ways to do it. I'll agree with you. There are tasteful ways to do it.
It's like I have the sleeves. I will play at locals, and they do not make their way to regional events.
Okay. It's, yeah.
It's like in the back of my Nami leader, I have a nice alt art or card.
The adjective "nice" being used to describe those sleeves. Okay.
I mean, the sleeves I have on my deck at the moment are two of my favorite anime, so Chainsaw Man again,
yeah,
and my Don deck is sleeved with My Dress Up Darling.
Okay.
So they're very tasteful at the moment.
I just, so this is nothing against your sleeve. I'm just thinking, like, I remember when, so Guilty Gear Strive, the fighting game.
Oh, we have that in Weiss.
There's Guilty Gear in there too.
We have Guilty Gear.
What an actual card game. Holy. All right. So one of the characters in the game, apparently, please, someone in the comments, if you're this far, please confirm or deny this. But as far as I'm aware, as much as I love that fighting game, I think the art style is great. The systems are great. One of the characters in that game, apparently, is like a 14-year-old girl that is hypersexualized, but apparently she's a 4,000-year-old alien that chose the body of a 14-year-old girl. And I'm like, no, please. There's something wrong with this, but maybe it's a culture thing I don't get. I don't think so. I don't know. I don't know. I think there's tasteful ways to do things. I think there's,
absolutely.
I have to stop. I have to make my statement of, I think there's tasteful ways to do things. But yes,
I mean, if I want to go super fluffy, I have so many Kirby sleeves. Like Kirby's my guy.
Yeah.
Kirby's just my little fella. I mean, he's with me forever. I have a little Kirby teddy.
Yeah. No, I think. Yeah. So I appreciate you saying, you know, kind of doing things in a tasteful way. I appreciate, you know, just kind of, especially like kind of exploring like art in different ways. I think there's a lot of degeneracy out there, which I think is a good way to transition into one of the reasons I appreciate you as a creator as well, is especially in my view, as I was mentioning, in a space that I feel like is very male dominated. In the One Piece TCG creator space, being a female in the space as well, being a successful female player as well. Like a lot of people will be like, you're a female in the space because of X. You're showing off this. You're showing off that. You're not a good player. But especially being a successful player within what a lot of people would consider an underrated or a frustrating archetype to play against. How do you feel like being that person in the One Piece TCG has been? What's your experience been like? And How do you navigate, I mean, what I would imagine might be some difficulties you face?
Yeah, I mean, coming into like using Twitter and stuff like that, I never thought I would be that person. But now it's like I rock up at regionals and people say like, oh, hi, it's nice to meet you. And it's just like, people know me now, which is weird.
Yeah.
And it's always just like, they'll talk to me about like stuff I've posted and stuff like that. And it's just like, oh, wow. People actually take what I say seriously. Because I think here in Australia or in Oceania, there's like 3 or 4 good Nami players. And I just happen to be one of them. But in saying that as well, I'm one of the only women in the continent that have consistently posted top results, which I think needs to happen in the game. Like, sure, you can run a TCG purely off blokes. Absolutely. Like, I always came into like playing cards and just saw like, oh, there's no other girls here.
Right.
And so being that one that posts those good results, it's just like, I want to be that one that's like, okay, I want that cereal. Mm-hmm. I want to be one of the first women in the world to have a cereal card. I want to go to Worlds. Like, and I know it's probably never going to happen, but it has to happen eventually.
And do you feel like this is a, like, kind of on that train, it's a sense of trying to prove something to yourself, prove something to others? Like, what do you feel like that motivation kind of stems from?
When I was a lot younger, I always had this thing of like, I would start something and never finish it sort of thing.
Yeah.
Like you'd start playing, I don't know, take for example, a Souls game like Dark right. Souls. Mm-hmm. You'd get halfway through, you'd get up to this really hard boss. You'd try it 100 times, you'd never beat it. And it's just like, I'm never going to touch this game again.
Right.
I just don't want to give up. Mm-hmm. Like I proved that to myself with martial arts. Mm-hmm. I stopped just before I became a black belt. Mm-hmm. And then I suddenly one day came to the realization of I quit when I was so close.
Right.
I can't do that to myself again. So I went back and got my black belt.
Mm-hmm. Congratulations.
So thank you. It was a while ago now.
Yeah, but still.
But yeah, I just want to see how far I can go. Mm-hmm. And it might not be Worlds. It might be coming second or third at an online regionals, mm-hmm. like whiffing right at the end. But it's still, I've done something that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and I'm happy you're bringing this up because I think a lot of people like the standards are too high, right? In the sense that mm-hmm. if you were to play second place, third, fourth, whatever, and you whiff at the end, it doesn't like how far you've come is a lot farther than like 90% of any other One Piece player, right? Like you have achieved higher than any other One Piece player out there, especially with your results, right? Like even those other people that have may have like in the tournaments that you may have top 32'd, the folks that have won that tournament may not ever place in a tournament ever again, but you have you have consistently gone back to tournaments. You have consistently participated in more events and doing that, you've placed yourself at the top 5%, 10%. I feel like mathematically, like that has to be true without any backup that I have. I feel like that has to be true of One Piece players in general. But how do you navigate some of the hate that you may or may not get, right? Because I feel like, and you may not see that yourself, I feel like you've proved to me that you are a top 1% Nami player, if not a top 5 or 10% One Piece player, right? You've proven that to me. But I imagine there are other people that don't take that seriously from you. They're like, oh, you played 32. Why didn't you play 16? You play second. Why didn't you play first? Okay, why didn't you? I don't know. That's my first reaction like to that. Why didn't you? How do you navigate? Yeah. I don't know. I don't know if you get any of this type of feedback on your end. I don't know if you get some of that hate. How do you navigate that? And if you don't, if everyone praises you, we can go next.
No, I definitely feel like I have this group of people at my locals and they're just like, we're all each other's hype men.
Okay.
Yeah. Like I said, in that last regionals, there was that one person that came seventh.
Yeah.
The cheer he got, it was like we all came seventh.
Yeah.
Like I definitely came into this and I wanted everyone to know that, hey, sure, I'm playing Nami. No one else plays it. But I want my wins to be our wins. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure, there's been some people that I've rocked up to like a winner box on a whim this one time to a place where I don't normally play.
Right.
And I've cleaned up. People will sometimes look at me and just think, oh, why did she even come here?
Right.
We didn't have fun or this right. or that. And it's like, I think the one comment I constantly get is that, oh, Nami isn't an interactive deck. Mm-hmm. I don't enjoy playing against it because of that. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, the 30 plus counters in my deck say otherwise.
Right. And I think it's a matter of perspective. Coming from the Magic space, being a creator, Jesus Christ, let me mute my phone, sorry. Coming from the Magic space, being a mill creator there as well, I think there's a lot of frustration with that archetype there. The mill archetype in Magic, at least, is milling your opponent. It's not milling yourself, although the more popular versions of it are milling yourself, I think, at large. But I think when people feel frustrated about Nami being uninteractive, I think is, and we can discuss this later on, leads to my frustration of design in this game. I think it's very limited. I think it's very combat focused, which I get it. It's about like battles. It's very thematic to the anime itself. And I think people are just mad when you break the status quo. And I agree. It's not like it is interactive for the Nami player. They feel like the Nami player is spinning their wheels, but I feel like it's a skill check for them. You're kind of just telling on yourself, right? Like you're kind of just saying that you can't beat the Nami player. I feel like.
Yeah.
I feel like you're just telling on yourself and saying that you're bad. I don't know how you feel about that.
I mean, I've had people at locals where I'd get to like 10 cards left in deck and they'd be like, oh, I may as well just scoop here because you've won.
Right.
And it's like, why not just keep playing?
Right.
Like, why make me feel bad for doing what my deck is meant to do? Right. Sort of thing.
Right, right. And then like you feel like, I mean, heck, I imagine you may be in situations like that where, heck, if they have conceded or you're looking at your hand, you're like, I'm not winning this game. Like you're looking at your hand, you're like, I'm not winning this game at all. Like I know all my Pilafs are gone, my Kaias are gone. Like they very well could win. And you need the experience to actually fight through those last 10 cards. So it's very valuable for you as well. But I think like, I agree. The frustration is very... it's very loud, I think, from a very loud group of people, which is very annoying. I think, I don't know. I have so many ways I want to take this discussion just in terms of like card design, alternate win cons, the fact that they keep leader locking everything in blue. Heck, discussion about Kabaji. But I agree. I agree with the frustration. I just think it's, like, I see it frustrating from an outside perspective for someone like you who's succeeding, who I imagine still goes through a lot of pushback, I imagine. You have a lot of opinions as well. Like, you know, I remember you recently tweeted about, like, Purple having, like, too much support. And all the Purple Warriors came out of nowhere. It's like Reddit put out a signal. They're like, get into the comments and hate this.
Absolutely, because I saw so many people trying to justify it as, oh, sure, we get everything, but we have to neg Don to do it.
Okay.
Which with cards like...
That's cope. That's cope. There's literally cards that say when you negative Don, you get Don back. That's cope. Okay, all right. Right, okay, all right, all right, all right. I think...
Yeah, no.
Okay, let's talk about it. Let's talk about purple. Let's talk about card design. Okay, let's start with purple. Yeah, we're going to get into some blue as well. Let's talk about purple. Okay. I think purple, and I'm going to, you know, feel free to agree or disagree. I'm going to start with a statement. I feel like purple is getting way too much support in OPO8. It is way too powerful right now based on the card design we have seen. The synergies are absolutely wild. Black Maria has to be one of the most abusable purple cards I've ever seen. 10 cost purple mom. Combined like new black king black purple king leader is insane. You can Sabo effect, like, yo, you can, what is the sequence? It's like at some point you can Sabo effect to to make sure your cards can't be KO'd, then you can 10 cost purple mom. You don't lose anything. You black Maria to get everything back. I feel like it's too much support. It's too much support. And people say purple has been bad for so long. We had a whole discussion about how red is busted.
Yeah.
What's your take on people just being like, let purple have its time in the sun?
No. No.
This is someone who's been traumatized by purple Luffy too much. Yeah, this is someone. This is coming from someone who just hates the Luffy matchup. But yeah, I agree.
I think it's poor card design on Bandai's part.
Oh, thank you.
Where there's always one big bad in the game.
Oh, it's just music to my ears. Like, there's so much logic coming from this whole interview.
Always,
Jesus, thank you for saying that.
There's always one or two big bads in the game.
Yeah.
Like, 02, it was Whitebeard.
Yeah.
03, Katakuri. Mm-hmm. 04, we don't talk about 04. Those leaders were doo-doo. I mean, what did 04 have? Isho, Rebecca, Vivi, Crocodile Queen,
Doodoo. Rebecca was probably like a positive place for the game because I think it was ultimately labeled as like a budget intro deck to the game. It was like a control list as well. So I guess like I think it had a positive aspect from that angle, but doo-doo leaders, bad leaders.
And then we get to wave 5, Sakazuki, Fluffy.
Oh, shit. And now we got Marco, which is functionally the same card, but better, arguably. So,
I mean, I'm not going to mind looking at the alt art leader. I'm just going to put that out there. Marco and King.
They got some arts on point. They got some arts on point. Not going to lie. Some good looking people. Yeah.
They're gonna go right into my binder. But yeah, no, I hate that there's always one or two big bads every set, and it's not like the game isn't balanced to a point where you can't, where just some leaders have no chance in winning a game.
Yep.
And it's just RNG at that point. If your opponent has a bad hand, you might steal a win here and there.
Yeah. No, I agree. I agree, and I'm happy you said it was card design. I think Bandai really lacks in its ability to take advantage of some of the things that already exist in the game. So the amount of leader locking that exists in blue is egregious. And people be like, oh, it's for Nami. Cope, bad card designers, okay? We can leader lock in other leaders too. I recently talked about this in like a short form video that I made where there's like a red card that came out that I think it's Clovenhoof in 08 and it has Chopper in the art. Realistically, it should have just been leader locked to Drum Kingdom, right? But now because it's open, it's pretty much just Zoro support or red green law support.
Is that the one, the 1K for the rest of the turn? That one?
It's like, no. So we can talk about that later. That one just got spoiled today or yesterday or something. This is another one.
Okay.
Yeah. This is another one. So this is, it gives like 3K to three of your characters, minus 1K to something. And then it has a decent trigger. Like, long story short, the frustration is that like, this should have just been a Chopper card because Chopper leader's coming out. And I think this is being underutilized, like leader locking and character locking. Like, it doesn't need to be leader lock. This could just gone on to a Chopper character or something like that. And I think that's what happens with purple. That's what happens with red. That's what happens with yellow. Like, these the yellow triggers are insane, but Big Mom only exists in Katakuri. So that's a balancing factor. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's extend that. Some of these triggers. Why do all these triggers happen for free? Like, you play the card, you draw some cards, blah, blah, without being leader locked. Purple cards. Like, their balance is the fact that they use Dawn minus effects, which I think is fine. But then once you start making the effects absolutely bonkers, the minus Dawn doesn't mean anything anymore. Like, what do you mean 10 cost mom comes down and KOs everything else? I don't care if I'm Dawn minusing 10.
If the king was purple and any other color, Yes. I think it would be fine. Yes, but because the king has access to that Sabo, that's where the poor design has come in, and Bandai should have really gone, huh, let's look back at the cards we already have.
Yep.
And is black the best color to put with purple on a really good leader?
I mean, is black just like, I think in general, the way black has been designed, I think it's a net negative for the game for multiple reasons. And I'm just going to point out price. From a playability perspective, Borsalino, Sabo, like you have like these crazy cards that are like extremely unattainable. And from like I've always pushed the fact that the game needs to be accessible from a casual perspective. You need to have reprints and you need to have decks and cards that people can afford. But there's no alternative. There's no alternative to Queen, like five cost Queen in purple. There's no alternative to Sabo in black. There's no alternative to Borsalino in black. There's no alternative to any of these, which is like, I think, really frustrating for me in this game. Like, it's one thing for the game to be designed terribly, but also, like, there are so many trash, dud, garbage cards in every set. So many. And you're telling me you couldn't print like alternative options to some of these cards? One more frustrating point. And I got this from a Twitter user, actually. They pointed this out. Where in the new OA trailer, they showed that five cost Queen is being reprinted as a special rare. That's not a reprint.
I was literally just about to say this.
Yeah, that's not a reprint. That's a slap in the face. That should never happen.
That's 100% a money grab. That is seeing people that have the Judge Foil Queens, and they're like, oh, Judge Foil isn't good enough for you guys. You guys need this beautiful, intricately designed, pretty card.
And like, I think it's like, there's this like small vocal minority of players that talk about, oh, my cards need to have value. I need expensive cards. What if I sell them back? That's not like honestly, in my opinion, those folks' opinions are ruining the game. Because in order to grow the game, you need to have new people coming into it. And when people see I need to spend $200+ on a playset of one card just to be playable, and there's no other option like Queen, why would I play this game? Right? Yeah, like they're coming from Yu-Gi-Oh! Where they're spending like, I would say Yu-Gi-Oh! Is relatively a cheaper game, but I know recently there have been some cards that have cost like a lot. Pokemon, Magic, they've come with like accessible routes. But One Piece doesn't have that. Why? No. Why did we only just get an announcement for a reprint set in Worlds? I don't know. Look, like I've been ranting. I've been talking too much. Please, give me your opinion. Like, I've been talking too
Nami much. Nami is that accessible route, though. Like, when I look at my deck here, base rarity for everything, I feel like it would cost you under $50.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, and especially I think Mellows have gone down, too. They used to be like $20. USD anyway, but I think they've gone down now.
Yeah, the regular printing for the Love Loves have gone down since the folder.
Yeah.
Oh my god, the folders. I hate folders, bro. I'm gonna need 4 gavels from a folder. What's next? I wish the live action Sanji card in his folder was his peel off. How good would that have been?
I wish the reprints were done better. I wish the way cards were printed were done better. They have models of how other games do it, and they refuse to take advantage of the lightning in the bottle that they have right now. The game can be so much better than it is right now. And I think I want to comment on what you mentioned about Nami being accessible deck. And I feel like what's unfortunate about that is that's a trap for a lot of people. Because Nami is probably one of the hardest decks out there to pilot. And it's also going to be a deck that gets a lot of people frustrated at you. And it might get you to hate the game, too. Because, like we both mentioned, we both started with Nami losing almost every game. And people don't want that. They want a deck like Whitebeard, where they can play and all of a sudden they're turning Zoro sideways and they're winning games. That's all they want, right?
Yeah. Whitebeard's brainless.
it's pretty brainless. Once you play it a bunch of times, you start seeing the same play patterns over and over again. It's pretty brainless. But you I don't know, like it feels like that there needs to be more accessible leaders that have good support, right? And it can't just be like some leaders can buff their characters and some leaders are Sakazuki.
Yeah.
Some leaders are Whitebeard that can be aggressive and lose life, but some leaders are Yamato that have double attack built into the leader. It just like the deck builds itself. Like you just play around your leader. Other decks, you build a deck and your leader works with the deck. Yamato is a deck that you just play around the leader. That's it, which I think is fine in a leader-based game. I don't know where I'm taking this. I'm just frustrated with the game. Tell me about your frustrations with the game. I'm frustrated with the game.
No, I feel like, one, the game needs to be more accessible. There needs to be more of it. Mm-hmm. I'm sick of every time my partner gets an allocation for a One Piece release and it's like 8 cases. When we have so many people that would be wanting to buy a case or chance their luck at a manga or... And we can't do that.
Right.
I feel like Bandai as a whole is just kicking themselves in the foot, not printing more. And sure, there's this amazing reprint set coming, but what if the reprints they have in that aren't the reprints we want? Mm-hmm. What if them Borsellinos, them Sabos, the Kuzans, the staples that we want, what if they just say, oh, we printed them in this set. Sure, this is a reprint set, but
I mean, there's multiple ways they could do it wrong. Like touching on the supply issue that you just meant, they could underprint it. They could print those cards at a higher rarity. There was that recent piece that I saw on Twitter where UK One Piece suppliers are delayed right now. I know there's a bunch of UK supply gone, and then there's some people that are, they're like, oh, you know, we need to give Bandai some leeway. They're trying. No, they're not. No. They monopolize the distributor. Yeah, multi-million dollar company.
Possibly billion.
And you're telling me, like, especially in the UK, the distributor is one distributor. They're monopolizing distributors. You tell me there's an other ways that they can do this. They're creating this environment. It just feels like a giant crypto Ponzi scheme to me. That's what it feels like. And you're right. I don't know. So that's the supply issue. Well, like, what do you have other frustrations with the game? Game is perfect.
No. I almost wish the language releases were simultaneous.
Oh, hallelujah. Thank you. Yes. Why are we a set behind?
Yeah.
We need to unify the set release. We 100% need to unify set release. I think being a year behind is awful. The fact that we can't use alt language cards across metas is horrible. That makes no sense. That would genuinely decrease the price of cards.
That, 100%. Like, the fact that I had a friend go over to Japan recently, and he picked up sets of alt art leaders for a major fraction of the price than what they're worth over here. And it's like, I don't have a problem with people using Japanese cards. If there's an English printing of it, if you can prove it's in English, 100% go for it.
Yeah.
It's like the Swords to Plowshare in half my decks are the alt art Strixhaven art, which is in Japanese. Of cards across my decks in Magic are Japanese because of Strixhaven, and no one bats an eyelid at that.
I will say, though, Magic is approaching a very unique problem over where there's too many damn alt arts of cards. So I will say that it is approaching a point where, like, cards like Swords to Plowshares, like Lightning Bolt and stuff like that, way too many alt arts. Like, I'll look at a card and be like, is that actually a Swords to Plowshares? Like, what is that? Anyway, that's...
I showed you that dog.
Fair enough. And some of them are pretty unique. I will say some of them are pretty unique and you can tell what it is. But I feel like Magic's approaching like a very like an opposite spectrum point where there's too many printings of staple cards where it becomes really confusing to the average player as to what it is.
Bro, all I need is a Gaia's Cradle reprint. I just, oh.
Hey, that card is so expensive, and I just want one. I don't care what language it's in. Speaking of supply issues, I'm happy this game does not have a reserve list, because the reserve list, I think uniformly for Magic, I think a lot of people agree, was right now, and again, we can't comment on this from the time being, they made a decision way back when that potentially could have saved the game. We don't know. We don't have a world where that didn't happen. They made a reserve list so that they wouldn't reprint certain cards and the price of those cards would constantly go up. Right now, we see it as a net negative for the game. Gaia's Cradle is on that reserve list. Powerful card, insane card. Of course, if you're in an environment like EDH where you could proxy it, sure, if your pot is proxy friendly, go for it. I'm just happy the One Piece TCG doesn't have that.
If it did, what do you think would be on
that? The game would fail. The game would fail.
Yeah. I feel like... if the game did have a reserve list, it would be the starter decks.
Which is still problematic. There's so many, it's a starter deck. It's a starter deck. Like people need to start with that deck. You know what I mean? And that's on the reserve list?
Yeah. But I feel like Bando would do something stupid like that.
You would have more experience. I come from Wizards of the Coast, and Bandai, this is my first interaction with Bandai. So you tell me, why do you believe that?
Just because my partner, he was the first regional champion for Dragon Ball here in Australia, or first national champion here in Australia for Dragon Ball, for the old trading card game. And just seeing the stupid bans they put in place for that game, Bandai does some dumb stuff.
Yeah. I've heard about it from my Yu-Gi-Oh friends as well, like the decisions they make and how like Bandai games are handled. I guess maybe I'm coming in as a boy who cried wolf, coming in to this game and just screaming about the issues of Bandai, and I have folks like you telling me just join the party, join the queue or something. Like, we've been screaming about this for years. Like, it's just there's so much that could go right with this game. I think printing, accessibility, cheating is definitely a big thing as well. And you kind of briefly brought it up where potentially a player was messing around with their Sakazuki list and everything. How do you feel about cheating in this game, the lack of response? Do you think it's actually that rampant at all, that there are a lot of cheaters? What do you think?
There's an easy way to combat it, and it's just an online client. Dragon Ball has one.
Logic.
And it's brand new.
Yeah.
Why isn't there one for One Piece already?
And you know what? We have the sim. Why aren't we able to use the sim? Is Bandai going to come and sue us? What is the ruling? Is there a ruling by tournament organizers that they can't use it? Is that what it is that's preventing us from using the sim? And the only reason I say that is, I'm not sure if you know the Lorcana TCG, the Disney TCG.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah. So they hold, I don't know if I want to call them official, but they hold big tournaments on their digital client that's unofficial. It's called Pixelborn. It's homemade. It's by images. So there's no purchasing. And it's made by one person, just like Meibatsu for the OPTCG sim. And the only thing you can buy on that client is cosmetic things. Like, you can make the animation slightly different, but it's all free, and they hold tournaments on that. Big 10K, 1K tournaments on that client. Why can't we do that for the sim? The template's there.
I feel like so many people would have a hissy fit being like, oh, but what if I misclick something?
Okay.
What if I do something, yada, yada, yada? I feel like there are so many keyboard warriors that would come out in troves if we purely had a sim tournament.
I'm going to publicly say this. This is not Lenore's opinion. This is my opinion. If your opinion of against the sim is that you will make a mistake, or people will make a mistake, and that's why we shouldn't have it, your opinion does not matter. That's the biggest cope excuse I've ever heard in my entire life. You just need to go GG and next. I have hundreds of videos on my main channel playing Magic on digital clients where I have misclicked. I have not stopped playing the game. The client succeeds, makes hundreds of thousands of dollars. People misclick all the time. It happens. Yeah. It's fine. It's perfectly fine. And if there's a bug, would you rather your game was destroyed because of a bug and you restart, or by a cheater who has someone underneath their table feeding them cards? What would you rather lose to? Pardon?
He's got to have his pick crew.
Jesus. Like, yeah, exactly, right? Like, exactly. Oh, yeah. Lord. I think one of the things that I want to do, and like as a creator myself, one of the things that I want to push is like create a rallying cry for the use of a digital client. I don't think these webcam events should be pushed, but I completely understand that they are primarily the one way that's accessible for a global audience to interact with each other in a competitive sense. So I'm not exactly advocating for their removal and disappearance. I just think we should push a different angle. I think the webcam events are fine for now, but I think it just opens up too much of an angle for cheating. There are multiple examples of people cheating live, in person, in paper, on camera, especially in Magic.
I've seen that. The guy with his bag open underneath his table. I saw that, and I'm like...
There's plenty of... People will find a way to cheat, but we can make good steps to prevent that. We can make good steps to prevent that. And then you know what? The one excuse I hate... When people are like, I have to buy my cards again, stop that. You went to the store and spent $600 on an alt art leader. Don't say that. No, you're a liar. Don't get mad at the fact that you have to rebuy your cards. You literally just bought an alt art leader for hundreds of thousands of dollars. Do not look at me and tell me you're mad that you have to rebuy your cards. That is an awful excuse. That is a terrible excuse. But that's the one thing I'll say. People are happy when they get their special, when they get their serialized Luffies, when they purchase them, but they're mad they have to rebuy their cards. Stop it.
Yeah.
Stop it. You engage in the capitalism that the One Piece TCG gives you. Don't make an excuse for it. But I will say I understand, especially from an accessibility perspective, a lot of folks can only buy the deck once. I will completely acknowledge people's financial situations, but a lot of times the vocal people about it are the people that can afford it.
Yeah. And that is so silly. Like, I don't understand why people don't want more people playing the game.
Yep. Exactly.
Like,
right?
That was crazy sauce to me. Like, I would love to rock up to like an online locals and there'd be hundreds of people there.
Yep.
Because there's that accessibility of, I don't need to purchase X, Y, and Z card to build this deck I want to play.
Mm-hmm.
I literally just need to upload a bunch of photos to an online client and bada boom, bada beanie deck.
Yeah, and then it translates from there. Like, yeah, you're playing some tournaments and locals and you're seeing a lot more people there, but then they're like, hey, I played this deck in an online tournament. I went well with it. I bought it in paper and now I'm here. People translate, right? Like, they want to take the success and go to... an in-person thing like that. That's genuinely a thing people want to do. More people need to play the game. More people need to interact. And I think it's very important for the diversity of the game as well. And I think it's just, I see a lot of takes on Twitter, a lot of people on Twitter, a lot of creators on Twitter that, especially in a game that is probably one of the most welcoming and open animes, worlds, just anything, diasporas out there in terms of how it accepts everyone. The fact that we have gatekeeping and hate in the One Piece TCG blows my mind. Pardon?
Don't look at my Twitter bio.
Wait, why?
Oh, no, I have Girl Boss Gaslight Gatekeep.
No, I.
Because it was a funny little thing that one of my friends said, like, after I top 28 at locals, and he was like, "Oh, you're such a girl boss. I love that for you."
That's all in good fun. You're not gatekeeping true people's fun. You're just gatekeeping the bad players because you beat them with Nami. That's fine.
Yeah.
But being accepting in the game. I don't feel like, I mean, hey, you don't need to out yourself if you are a hater, but I don't feel like you're a hater in the game. I don't feel like you're bringing people down. From the interactions I've had with you, and I've seen the interactions you've had with other people, I don't believe you are a net negative on this game. I think you are a net positive as a creator and a person and a player. But I think a lot of people in this space are different. I think if you've come this far in this interview, you may understand who I might be alluding to, but I'm not going to call names. We need to be a bit more accepting in this game to people. And we need to call out the bad actors. We need to call people out for being crappy people, because that's what Luffy would do. That's what Luffy would do.
Everyone, yeah. After a quick second break, just to talk about some things in the background. Lenore is back with her phone camera. Shout out to, what phone model is this?
iPhone 15.
Shout out to the iPhone 15 for the beautiful, the color range and the light bringing it in. So for a long time, I would do my short form content on like a unused like iPhone 7. I can attest to the fact that the iPhone cameras are just better. I can attest to that. So yes, you did not look terrible, or any comment you had toward yourself on your camera, on your laptop, but damn, the iPhone 15, there you go. If there ever was an ad for it, it's this one. But yeah, so let's hop on back to the discussion. Let's close things off. We've been talking for a bit, a little bit of everything here. I think the last thing we wanted to kind of touch on is just, I guess, around etiquette when playing the game. And just deck etiquette in terms of maybe touching your opponent's cards, sleeving your own stuff. What are some comments you have when you're playing in person, sleeving up your deck? What are some comments you have around deck etiquette?
Yeah, One Piece being a card game that you're only allowed to double sleeve, I would just have to say, make sure the deck is consistent all the way through. Like, I know a lot of people use, like, the katanas or the dragon shields, and I do that for my magic decks, mostly. So, because my decks are sort of expensive, I want my cards to be protected, and I can understand that with the price of some of those One Piece alt arts. Like, seeing people play with mangas, I was like, pop off, queen!
I wouldn't feel comfortable with that at all. Can you imagine someone taking your deck and riffle shuffling it, and you got a manga in there?
Bro, don't speak to me about that. I had someone... Okay, so that signature from the Seven Deadly Sins that I showed you, that is a $500 card.
Oh, shit.
I have a playset of them in my deck.
Okay, yeah,
If anyone was to ruffle shuffle or aggressively shuffle that deck respectfully, you're not saying you're gonna leave in a body bag, but
look, so I'll say this in a competitive environment, I will ask people, so I will do this myself, so I know especially like with magic players, they like their shiny foils as well, and I will ask them, especially in a tournament environment, for my own protection of cheating, I am going to be shuffling your deck. Right? Like, I am going to, I don't know, like, whatever you call, like, where is it? Whatever you call this shuffle, where you just kind of
A normal.
Yeah, yeah, just a normal kind of combined shuffle. I'm going to be doing that and splitting a couple of times. Like, rather.
As soon as you go like that, I'm like, nope, hands off my deck.
And I think I'll tell people I will not be riffling, but if you feel uncomfortable with me mashing your deck together, please let me know. Otherwise, we need to find a way to randomize your deck. Because, like, I personally will feel comfortable if the deck is randomized. But I understand. I will never riffle shuffle, though. Because that genuinely bends the card. That genuinely bends the card. Do not do that with other people's commons. I don't care. Don't do that. Let the person make that decision. Heck, even if they're the one riffle shuffling their manga rares, do not riffle shuffle it back. Just let them make that decision. That's their problem.
Absolutely.
I agree. Ask people. But also randomize other people's deck. Prevent them from cheating. Make the effort to randomize that person's deck. Go on.
If something looks wrong with that deck, point it out straight away.
Deck check. You got judges for a reason. Exactly. You got judges for a reason. Like, legitimately call over a judge and say, I have a suspicion about something in their deck. Can you please check it? That's their job. call them over. That's your job. And if you get penalized for that, that's a problem, and you should call that out. Like, you should genuinely, like you should not be called out for... Of course, if you're deck checking every 5 minutes every single round, you're the problem. But you're allowed to deck check, like, a couple times during a tournament, especially in a top table if you have a suspicion.
Absolutely.
Etiquette-wise, sleeving consistently. I think we were just talking about how, you know, you came up against a round in a certain tournament where someone had... their deck sleeved in different ways. And I will point out straight up for anyone that does this, this is cheating. You cannot have some card sleeved single and some card sleeved double. That's cheating because your thickness of your cards are different. And that means that you can, in a vacuum, tell which cards are which. That's legitimately cheating. So don't do
that. I mean, it's like when I had my hands on his card, because I only realized like 2/3 of the way through the match.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was looking through his trash and I was like, I was just shuffling through and I was like, why does this one feel weaker?
Yeah, exactly.
And it was, I just was starting to like look closer and I'm like, there's no inner sleeve.
Yeah. And in that situation, I don't know how you handle it. You don't need to go into it, but I would recommend calling a judge. That's a deck check. That should be a round loss because that's... That's cheating. That's not
unfortunately. Yeah. Unfortunately, the judge for me said continue playing. And after the game, this was round 7, mind you.
I'm not going to comment. I'm actually going to get mad. Go on. I'm not going to comment. That's so frustrating.
This was round 7. And
that's insane.
Yeah. So I think, because I'm not the type of person to rule shark. I genuinely said to him, like, hey, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to call a judge on that. And that's just me. Like, I feel bad when I have to do that to someone. Because it's just like, hey, this isn't on you. This is just me wanting to get an outsider perspective. And the perspective of someone that's more knowledgeable in the game than I am.
So I will say on the record, I 100% agree with you. I believe you are 100% in the right. And I also believe that person should have been given a round loss and told to resleeve their deck. That is legitimately cheating. And all other TCGs, to my knowledge, would disqualify that person. Heck, they might even get, or they would give them a round loss at least. At least they would give them not even a game loss. So in Magic, you play best 2 out of 3. It would be the whole match. At least, bare minimum. The fact that that judge did not do that is insane to me. That's insane.
So there were 2 judges that came over, and I was surprised that both of them agreed that it wasn't going to be a game loss. Because I was like, I didn't want to say anything in the moment, but it was like... Sure, my opponent said he wasn't doing it maliciously or anything like that. And he possibly couldn't have been. It could have honestly been a mistake. But at the end of the day, it was a mistake that...
He'd
gone 7 rounds without someone picking it up.
Yeah, I think that's what this is about. This isn't an attack on the person. I know you haven't, you're not attacking the person. I hope I haven't alluded to the fact that I'm attacking the person. This is simply the action. You cannot do this. This is all this does is simply say that someone with malicious intent can do this, which is inappropriate. Yes. You cannot, even with good intentions. I hope someone is watching. I hope multiple people are this far in the video and agree. If you're watching this on YouTube, I need you to comment down below whether or not you agree, but that is inappropriate. That is incorrect. Those judges are actually wrong, and I will call that out. Not like I won't call it out now. I'm just saying if someone was to bring this up to me in the future, those judges were wrong.
Yeah.
And this is a Bandai problem. Like, that is actually just not correct. And I'm not saying that you should have rule-sharked and got a win there. But it's about stopping cheaters. It's just about stopping cheaters.
Yeah. And it's why the first thing I did was apologize, because I if I was in that situation, I wouldn't want the person rule shocking or just judge calling me to be, I wouldn't want them to be a dick about it.
Right. I think you handled that really well. Yeah.
Yeah. I would want to be given the same courtesy as what I gave my opponent and just being like, hey, I've noticed something that's not right. And can we just get a judge in to have a look at the situation? And yep. That's how it was handled. The two judge calls I made on during the Brisbane Regionals, I felt so bad for both of them.
Yeah.
So the first one was round one against Reiju. My opponent accidentally drew two cards for turn. And I had looked away for a split second. And he said he had put the card back straight away, that he didn't see what it was. But because I didn't see that, I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Like, I felt so bad in that situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it's a hard one to navigate. I think, I don't know what would be correct. Like, would you, I guess, like, the default is to call a judge there? I don't know. It's hard. That's a tough one. I wish the rules were a bit more comprehensive for our game to judge what you could do in that situation. I don't know. That's unfortunate. Yeah. In that type of situation, yes, mistakes happen. Drawing two cards. I would hope that in the comprehensive rules for the One Piece TCG and judging rules, there is a guide as to what to do. I would hope so.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I'm looking to take the judge test soon or eventually, just not to judge events, but to expand my card knowledge.
Yes, we have a Nami player on the inside. Everyone in the comment section down below, in Oceania, we have someone on the inside. Go do your regionals at Oceania. Yes, we did it. We won.
No, I also just won, like, I feel like the judge team also needs a bit of feminine touch sometimes.
Right.
Like, I feel like I will handle things a lot differently than someone who's got a more critical mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Like, 100% you should have a critical mindset as a judge. But I am also a person that's like, oh, you're human, you're going to make mistakes, sort of thing.
Right.
But first and foremost, the rules of the game are what come first.
Yeah.
But I feel like if I'm a judge, I'm not going to be like a douche about any judge calls I would make.
No, but especially as someone who, you know, is playing a game that has a lot of people facing aspects on it, and especially someone who's, you know, in the working world, working in a position that has a lot of, you know, people interactions, I think you can understand as well that you can do some of these things in parallel where you can be strict or you can be direct with someone, but also be positive about it, or also be, you know, professional about it. There is, you know, there's a tonality to it. There's the words you're using, you know, there's everything that you can do about your body language as well to convey something directly, but also not be, as you mentioned, just a complete prick about it.
Yeah,
that's a skill. That's a skill a lot of people don't have. I agree. A lot of judges in Magic that I've come across don't have that skill either. So I appreciate it. Someone who is looking to get into that space, I think that's also going to be a net positive for the game, to have someone like you in the space, in the judge sphere.
I think the main comment I gave my opponents were people that were using unsleeved character sleeves. I literally think, like, my main comment to them was just, please get some oversleeves and protect your sleeves
for the love of God. I think a lot of people don't understand how those sleeves are made, especially. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are made pretty cheap. They will split. They will scratch up the character sleeves as well in terms of the art. If you're getting character sleeves, you are probably a bit, on average, more invested in the game. Get some oversleeves. They're pretty cheap.
Yeah.
They're pretty cheap.
It's like I have a whole wad of spares.
Yeah,
when they eventually split, because I am an oaf when I shuffle and I will split the sleeves.
Yeah. Oh God. I miss the old Ultra Pro sleeve quality. Ultra Pro was, I remember the penny sleeves. You could buy like 100 for $3 or $5 or something. And oh Lord, those sleeves would split, but they're much better now.
I guess,
but they're much better now. But yeah.
But yeah, I think we've had a great discussion around etiquette, the game itself, some Nami, and I'm happy we've had this discussion. I think one of the ventures we've taken together is one thing I do want to shout is just that Nami Discord. So that's going to be linked down below for anyone that wants to join that Discord for masterclasses with Lenore and just a more focused community around Nami instead of just that one thread in the One Piece Discord or whatever, right? You know, like Come in here, have the discussion. You know, it's a growing community. A lot of people have those discussions. There's a lot of spaces to discuss deck lists and everything. Again, link down below. If you're this far in the video, you're a dedicated Nami player. Hopefully 90% of you are probably in there already, but bring yourself in there. But yeah.
And if I see any haters, I will enforce the ban hammer.
Oh, 100%. 100%. We literally had a whole section about haters. Like, okay. Mm-hmm. Criticism and hate is very different, and some of y'all don't know the difference.
Absolutely.
So there's a very big difference. You're allowed to disagree, but hate is something different. So some of y'all need to learn the difference. But yeah, is there anything more that you wanted to touch on yourself, or are we okay to kind of go into some closing comments?
I think we're good to go.
Okay, perfect. All right, so we've had a great 2.5 hour discussion. Holy. we've had a great 2.5 hour discussion. Thank you for joining me on the call today. I would love to do more of these kind of later on, especially if you're continuing down some tournaments or more things kind of happen here. Especially if you become a judge. Honestly, if you take that test and you become a judge, I'd love to hear your experience judging certain events and what that looks like from your perspective. So maybe I'll pin that as a future discussion, but...
I did have the opportunity to commentate the last Brisbane Regionals.
Really?
Yeah, I was actually contacted by the TO day before.
Yeah,
this was hours after I had bought my ticket. So I messaged him back and I said, I am so sorry. I would absolutely do it if I had not bought my ticket like a few hours previously.
Yeah. That would have been such a cool opportunity. Okay.
Yeah, no. And I spoke to him and we agreed that later on down the line, definitely. Yes. But I think it would probably be best for me to start an online event.
Okay.
So I feel like I'm going to need my laptop there with the whole One Piece card database. When someone plays that one random card, I'm not sat there deer in headlights.
And I feel like, especially, like, I know me personally, I definitely do not have the card knowledge in this game to commentate any game. I barely do for Magic. For the formats that I play, I barely do as well, but I think I can do a decent job. But for One Piece, No.
Which
I don't know the cards.
Which is definitely why I want to start an online event.
Yeah. Like, I would sit I was going to say, I would sit there and be like, Borsalino is a cool card. Next. Yeah. Like, you know, like, it's a blocker.
I'm like, oh yeah, that's Gekko Moria. That's a cool eight drop.
Nice.
Oh yeah, you get some stuff from your bin?
Yeah, no, and looks like they got two things, not one. Nice.
Right.
You know what I mean? Awesome. Nothing.
I'd be the worst commentator.
And you know what? It comes with practice too. I think, like, the more you talk about it, and especially what's nice, I guess, is with big events like this, I guess you are going to see a lot of the same cards. Like, if you were to commentate like that Brisbane Regionals, you'd probably see a lot of the same cards. So that's kind of nice. But if it's like an online, like, webcam event, like even like a big tournament, because it's like a higher variety of the pool, like people from everywhere,
might
get some random spicy stuff in there.
Absolutely. If someone came out with like playing something stupid like Isho, I couldn't even tell you what the leader effect is.
Cut that. I'd be like, I need to commentate the next game, not this one.
Yeah, I'd be like, someone please get me out of here.
Yeah, cut that. I don't know. Absolutely not. Like, I struggle. Like, if someone had like Don Quixote, like if they brought him on, and they're like, I'd be like, oh, blocker.
Wait, how do you say it?
I say Don Quixote.
Oh, Don Quixote.
Yeah. Is that
okay?
How do you say
Don Quixote? Don Quixote.
Okay, I guess yeah? I'm maybe like enunciating, the individual syllables.
Okay.
More. Yeah, I think I'm just enunciating more. But yeah, I'll look at that later and be like, blocker, restand. Oh, okay. All right. Ooh. I don't know how to build this deck. All right. Right? Like, I don't know what to do. Like,
maybe seen one random geezer play at my locals that one time.
Yeah, sure, exactly. Cool, I played against this deck once. Still don't know anything about it. I'd be furiously searching One Piece top decks, Sakazuki list. Like,
just give me like a CDH rec, but for One Piece.
Can we talk about how this game doesn't have anything like that yet? We need.
Oh my god, it's amazing.
We need a unified Scryfall EDH rec. Like, we need something like this. Like, I have one that I use that doesn't have like 07 cards, which is a nightmare. Yes. Like, I want everything. Like, we don't have this. Someone do it. This is a free idea. Go make an actual unified One Piece card game database. That is, I'll tell you what, and you know what? Because Magic has this too. That has integrations with TCG players, so you can look at prices. That has different arts for it. Like, I want it all. This game deserves
it. It's why Moxfield is one of my favorite websites to build decks on.
Great deck builder. Yep. Great.
Because I'm building a deck and I know, okay, it's going to cost me this much. Cool.
And you can goldfish it too. You can go into like the hand simulator. Like, it's great.
We need one for One Piece.
100%. I agree. These resources, I've been screaming about this forever. It's so hard. Also, is this an artwork thing? Can we get sample out of the artwork for these cards? Can we get the sample thing out of there? Like, as a creator, like, can we get the sample thing out of there? No? Yes? Maybe?
Yeah.
All right.
Surely.
I guess so. Anyway, we went into a whole other rant there. Let's end everything off there. Thank you everyone for watching. This has been a great discussion, and hopefully here's to many more, not only discussions, but successful games of Nami's adventures with Nami, for you. Heck, for me, I'm just going to push the name of the game, but to succeed, that's your job. Not me. That's not my job. Your job is to succeed.
No pressure
whatsoever. So I'll leave it off there. Thank you for having me. Is there any final kind of words that you want to put out there?
Not really. I think I've said everything. Just don't be salty when you play against Nami. Please. It's a good learning experience. You need to learn the matchup. And if people get salty at you playing Nami, it's a skill issue.
You've won. I would say if they get salty at you playing Nami, you've won already. You're in their head. Yeah. You've won the mental game already, and that's 90% of the battle.
Absolutely.
So if they're mad at you, GG, go next. You won. But words to live by. Words to live by there. Thank you for joining me, I should say. And I don't know how to end off any of my videos or my things. If you watch them through, sometimes I don't know how to end them. So we're just going to say bye.
All right, see ya.
Well, actually, before we go, no, wait. I should tag where people can find you. Where can people find you? Oh, God.
Twitter, I guess, is the main one.
Yeah.
So my @ is LenoreLouise0.
Link down below, of course.
Thank you. And yeah, I'm always there posting, just praying and hoping that Kabuchi is taken off the ban list. My Lord and Savior, I need him.
I can't talk about Kabuchi this podcast. We've talked too long. I can't talk about Kabuchi. All right. We must hope. But yes, find Lenore on Twitter. Of course, if you are in the Nami Discord, you can find her there. But please don't just be there and adding both of us. We got things to do. Okay, we're just not like Discord demons just sitting there waiting for y'all to tag us so we can respond. Yeah, please don't at me actively on Discord. I get too many notifications on Discord. Find us on Twitter. Same. Find us on our socials. They'll all be linked down below. Thank you for having me in this discussion. And let's say something corny. Let's all go find the One Piece. Woo!
Woo!
All right, bye everyone.
See ya.